What's going on, everyone? This is Black Marc Andre. Join me right now on the Stories of Music. All right.
And welcome, everyone, to another edition of Les Holmes Stories of Music. I'm your host, Les Holmes, and we are in for a very special treat today. We have someone that we haven't had before on this show, not just the person, but as far as what they do. We have an instrumentalist, which is a bass player. He's a bassist, composer, arranger, producer, and he brings a very unique style of music, which he calls the Fifth Avenue Funk. So we're going to let him tell us about what that's all about here in just a little bit. That's what we're going to do. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's Marc Andre. Welcome to the show, Marc. How you doing, man? So, Marc, man, tell me about this Fifth Avenue Funk. What's that all about?
Okay, it's a mixture of different types of genre music, kind of like a mosh pit. I call it old school hip hop funked out with a hump and a reggae jazz twist.
That boy said with a hump. That put a hump in your back, sucker. Where'd that come from?
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of smooth jazz artists, you know, they have their style of music where, you know, everything is smooth, but the music, on top of just my playing, I want the music to be bumping where people, like, you know, they're bobbing their head, even if there's nothing going on. If the music is jamming, then it's like when you put that bass on top of it, it's like the cherry on top.
All right. So, man, let's go back to the beginning. So you started out, when did you actually start? You started in high school, playing in band, or, mm-hmm. How did it all start?
Well, you know, I was brought up here in Houston, on the South Side, so I attended Madison High School. And back then, I was in this marching band, but in the stage bands. So they used to have the competitions around town, around the state. And at the time, Cashmere was like the band. Everybody was working to be good as them. We had gotten to a point where we were really better than everyone in the city and the state, but we couldn't compete against Cashmere or Forest Brook. Those were the two bands we were always trying to get after. So it was like, it wasn't until my senior year after Prof had retired that we finally got them at the U of H Jazz Festival. And that was like the great, you know, great thing. So even though people were coming up during the time, this is like late 70s, early 80s, you know, everybody was into the Parliament Funkadelic, Prince, Earth, Wind. But we were like into stuff like Stanley Clark, Return to Forever, Billy Cobb, him, that type of stuff. And so it was, man, that was some really good times.
Man, I was sitting here looking at your bio, and I'm looking at where you, man, you on the road with some pretty big folks. Like, man, you got Bobby Bird in your bio, man. Talk to us about Bobby Bird. Tell us who Bobby Bird is.
Okay, if you remember the movie Get On Up with James mm-hmm. Brown, yeah. His best friend was Bobby Bird. That's who that was. Okay. When they had the scene where all the original Bambas left, he was the only one who stayed. And that's when they went and got Bootsy Collins and his band, you know, to back him up. Well, I don't know if a lot of people knew that Bobby and Vicky actually lived here in town. They lived in Windsor Village. And at the time, my parents lived like right across the street. So we're little kids, and you know, we used to see the tour buses come through. They have big parties. And at the time, I mean, I would see Larry Graham, Sly and the Family Stone, Bootsy, all these, you know, stars. But, you know, you're like a little five, six-year-old kid, you know. But it was cool. But anyway, they moved out of town like in the mid-70s. Mm-hmm. And I never saw them or anything like that until like the mid-90s. By that time, yeah, I'm into music. I'm with a label. And one of Bobby's sons, Bart, is actually still here in town. And he knew that I was playing in the circuit.
Okay.
So I don't know if you remember the Jack the Rapper in Atlanta they used to have.
Yes, sir.
It was a big convention.
Sir. Right? Yes, sir.
And so I was able to attend that. And so while I was there, Bart, I said, make sure you get in contact with my dad. And so while I was there, you know, I went to his house and everything. So I hadn't seen him like the end of 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And
so
at the time, I actually had an album out, had a music video out, and they were just like blown away. And so Bobby tells me, he's like, you know, I want to help you. I'm going to do something nice for you. And I didn't really think about it too much. But then a year later, Bart calls me and tells me, say, you want to go on the road? And I'm like, man, don't check a jive with me like that. And he said, no, I'm serious. So the thing was, I had to fly to Atlanta, and we like rehearsed for about 3 weeks before we went overseas to Europe. And like that first time, that first rehearsal, don't forget it, it was just like yesterday. You know, all of the musicians have this certain type of swag. It's like confidence, right?
Yeah.
Not just saying that you're braggadocious or anything. You just got a little swag. And so, you know, you just want to kind of show them, hey, you know, I can hold it down. So that first practice, I'm doing my thing and stuff. And everybody's looking at me like crazy. And then they just start talking like, man, send him back to Houston. Man, this guy's garbage. And it broke me down. I mean, it totally broke me down. I mean, that night I cried like a baby.
Come on now.
Bart was saying, look, man, no, I'm for real. And so Bart was like, man, look, all they doing is just like, they just want you to humble yourself. I say, I get it. So he gives me the show and he's like, man, next couple of days, just study it. And that's all I did. I mean, I studied it like flies on honey.
Yeah.
And so then, you know, everything was going good. So when we started on the tour and we were in Europe, we started in small cities in Germany. And it was kind of like, you know, you kind of warming, you know, kind of getting everything warmed up to get the show tight.
Mm-hmm.
I kid you not, by the time we get to about the 7th or 8th show, man, everything was just like a machine. I mean, everything was on point. And one thing that I loved about being with him, I mean, it's just like they depict him on the movies. Man, they want you to make sure you don't miss nothing.
Yeah.
And you just follow him like the quarterback. You follow him. And like how they were saying back in the day when they would flash the five, like James would flash the five, that was like a $50 fine if you miss a part. You know, Bobby's the same way. So,
wow.
You know, there was a couple hits I missed. I didn't miss after that. That was it. Because I was like, I couldn't afford to lose no more money. So I toured with him for like 3 years.
Okay.
And that was a great time. It was a great time. Yeah.
So tell me about being on the road with or performing with the Rose of Gospel, Miss Dorinda Clark Cole.
Well, I didn't actually perform on the road with her.
Okay.
She actually did a concert here in town. Mm-hmm. And at the time, all she brought was like her producer. So it was like the musicians, we had to learn her music. And then once we learned the music, the producer came in front. So make sure that everything was on point. And so, and then once she arrived, I mean, you know, we did our thing.
I got
that
you.
That was a nice experience.
All right. So I think you have a story. It kind of reminds me of a show that was out in the 80s. I think it's the Home Alone story. What happened with that?
Ooh, yeah. Okay. Hope you guys have a few minutes because I'm going to break this one all the way down. We did a show in East Berlin, and Bobby was the headline in that. And it was like just a bum diggity, but it was late. So we didn't finish the show till like 4 a.m. So anyway, we had to go to Dortmund. That was the next city that we were playing. And Bobby was like the headline act. So the tour manager, whose name was Urs, he was from Switzerland. So he basically told everybody, hey, don't get comfortable in your hotel. We need to get on the bus because the bus ride was like 7 hours from Berlin to Dortmund. So I go and take all of my stuff, go ahead, load it on the bus. And of course you have your passports and you have your itinerary. So the itinerary was Dortmund that day. The next day was Stuttgart. And then we were going into Switzerland. So anyway, I already have everything loaded up. So he comes to me and he asks me, he said, hey, man, can you help me to get everybody up on the bus? So basically, he just had me to help him do his job. All right, so I'll go around and go to the doors and knock on and say, hey, we got to go, blah, blah, this, blah, blah, that. All right, so by that time, I told him, I say, hey, I'm going to be over here in the lobby. I'm going to get me a donut, some coffee, and kind of chill till we're ready to go. So anyway, I'm doing my donuts and coffee. Like 30 minutes pass, 45 minutes pass. And so I go to the receptionist and I ask her, I said, hey, have you seen the Bobby Bird, Vicki Anderson entourage? And she said, well, I think they left already. Well, okay. I said, well, the venue was like 2 blocks down the street. So I walked down the street thinking they're getting the rest of the equipment. Get there, the venue's closed. And so at this point, you know, kind of getting a little nervous there. So I run back to the hotel. And at that time, there's no bus. You know, I'm like, I'm here by myself. And I'm like, wait a minute. One of the things that we always did was every time we were on the bus, we would always do a roll call, make sure that everybody's on the bus when we pull up. So I'm saying to myself, how did they not do a roll call? Because I'm not on the bus. And then how did the tour manager leave me in the lobby after helping him getting everybody on the bus? Now I'm thinking, here I am. I'm in East Berlin. I'm a black man. I don't know the language. My passport, itinerary, clothes, everything, equipment, all that's on the bus. Okay, the only thing that I knew is that we were playing in Dortmund that day, that evening. We were the headline band. We were going to Stuttgart the next day, and then we were going into Switzerland. Uh-huh. Okay, so I asked the receptionist, she could speak English. I said, is Dortmund a big city? Is it possible to fly there? And she tells me, said, well, it's best that you take the train, but you have to go to West Berlin to get on it. Okay, mm-hmm. So she draws me out a map because I have to get on a city train to go from East Berlin to West Berlin, mm-hmm. right? And so she looked up everything as far as the time the train leaves. By this time, it's about 9:30-ish, you know, 9:45, and the train doesn't leave until 11 o'clock. Okay, so she gives me the map and everything, and I tell her, I said, look, when I get there, if anybody calls, tell them that I've gotten on a train to Dortmund, and meet me at the train station to pick me up. Okay, so now here I go. I'm going out on faith. Here I go. And I get on the city train. And back then, before they came with the euro, they had the Dutch mark. So I'm on my Dutch marks on the train. Okay, so I get to West Berlin. And I have some pictures that I had that I sent you. And so I get there to the train station. And so when I get there, it's about 10:30-ish. And no, that's the concert venue.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the other one.
What is that?
Yeah, that's it right there. Yeah.
Okay.
That's the train station I had to go to. Okay.
Okay.
So I get to the train station, and like I say, it's maybe 10:30-ish, and I go in there to get in line, and I'm looking in the line, and it's like there's no way I'm going to be able to get on this train by 11. And the worst part of it is that the next train doesn't leave until 3 o'clock.
Wow.
So here I am, and I'm like, what am I going to do? So I hear this older couple that was kind of up in front, and they were speaking English. So I walk up there, and I ask them, I have my little badge, and I tell them who I am, and I'm with Bobby Bird and Vicky Anderson. I say, I need to get on this train ASAP. I say, is it any way that you can talk to these people and kind of explain where, you know, so I could get on this train? And sure enough, they did it. And I was able to get on the train. So I'm like, thank you, Jesus. So I'm on the train, right? So I'm cool for a while. So I get to Dortmund, right? And I'm at the train station. So I call back to the hotel in Berlin. And the receptionist was still there. And I said, hey, this is Marc, you know, the one from Bobby Bird's entourage. I said, have you heard from them? And they said, no. And I'm saying to myself, are you serious? And they said, no. Okay, so now, all the thing that I knew, again, we were playing in Dortmund, but we were playing at a university, and it was an outdoor music festival. Okay, so what do I do? So I go and get a map. And now I need to read this map. But you got to remember, everything is written in German.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So I see this one place that doesn't look too far from the train station. It says Bassist. Okay. So I just start walking. I go walking. Takes me about a half an hour. I get there. I see festival, and I see all this stuff, and so I'm thinking I'm here. So I go into the auditorium, and they're setting stuff up, and I see this one guy, and he's speaking English. So I go up to him. I say, hey, have you seen the James Brown, Bobby Bird entourage, Vicky Anderson entourage? And they said, no. I said, well, they're the headlining act. They said, well, they're not performing here. And you know, like now I'm Twilight Zone now. Okay. Yeah. Now the worst part is it's about 5 o'clock now. So time is starting to get late. Okay. And I mean, I'm not even at this point, I'm not even thinking about the gig because I don't have my passport. Yeah. I don't have my itinerary. So that means I'm stuck in Germany right now if I don't get out. Okay. So I walk back to the train station, and I see another place, but it looked like it's further away from the train station. But it's like, there's no way I'm going to be able to walk this. So I'm going to get a taxi. So they have the taxi cabs. Now, I don't know if because I was a black man in Germany or, you know, they had the racist thing going on or they couldn't speak English. So, you know, I'm like, taxi, taxi. I'm waving, taxi, taxi. And nobody's responding. Nobody's like, okay. So then I pull money out. Dutch marks, Dutch marks. Nothing. And I'm like, damn, really? Okay, so what else is there to do? I have no choice. I start walking. So I'm walking through the streets of Dortmund. Black man, don't speak the language, never been there before, by myself. So I'm walking. And I'm walking, I'm talking about walking. So maybe about a good hour, hour and a half later, it's like probably close to 7 o'clock. here comes a taxi coming down, and I wave them down, and then they lower the window, and I say, can you take me here, y'all? Because I don't know if they can speak English. And so I get in, and I'm telling him my sob story, and come to find out, it was a Hispanic guy that moved from Los Angeles to Germany. Don't ask me why or how or whatever. You know, I'm just glad I had somebody I could talk to.
Yeah.
So finally, we get to the university, right? And I'm seeing all these people, Sal, and I'm hearing music. So I'm saying, this has to be it. Now, I have a picture also on there. If you could pull it up, there's one I'm right at the university. You see all these people walking around, and I'm just like at this pole, just like, you know, just like exasperated. So, yeah, that's it right there. So by that time, the sound stage is like right around the corner. And so I see the sound man, and I ask him, I say, please tell me this Bobby Bird and Vicky Anderson is performing here. And he said, yes. So it was like the orangutan came out, like, whoa, I feel better. But now the anger is starting to kick in, right? So I asked him, I said, do you know what hotel they're staying in? He said, yeah. He said, give me a minute and I'll take you there. So we get to the hotel and I'm in the lobby and I call up to Bobby's room. So when I call up there, he answers. Now, they gave me a nickname. The nickname they gave me was Gatekeeper. So he calls. He said, hey, Gatekeeper, you still in Berlin? I said, no. I said, I'm down here in the lobby. I said, is Us in your room? He said, yeah. He said, hold him there. So I'm going up the elevator. I get to the room. I knock on the door. Us answers the door. And the next thing you know, it's on. We just on. We just at it. I mean, they're just at it. So, you know, they pulling me off this dude and everything. And, you know, at that point, I was like, you know, how the hell you could leave me in freaking Berlin doing your damn job, right? I mean, I just went off. So then his excuse was like, when everybody got on the bus, and I have a picture. If you pull up the bus picture, the tour bus.
I don't have that one.
You don't have
I don't have that one.
Okay.
No. Yeah, I don't have that one.
Okay. Well, in on the tour bus, they had these bunk beds. Okay. So anyway, after after they pulled us apart, I asked Us, I'm like, why you left me behind? Why did they do a roll call? So on the tour bus, they had bunk beds where everybody could go in and sleep, basically. So they were saying that they didn't do a roll call. They just figured everybody got in the bed and went to sleep. And they didn't realize I wasn't on the bus until they arrived at the hotel 7 hours later. And so I was like, hey, first of all, I definitely want to be reimbursed for for paying for the train. And it was like, hey, you get paid to do that job. So, hey, don't come back at me again. So never had to worry about that ever again. And that's a lesson learned. It's like, hey, when ask you to do something and it's their job.
Yeah.
You know, stay in your lane. My lane was to play bass.
Right.
And that's it.
So let me ask you this. So
but that was my Home Alone story. I was like,
ooh. All right. So who is this gentleman right here? Who is this?
Oh, okay. You know, they had two original drummers, right? They had Clive Stubblefield.
Yeah.
And that guy there, that's Jabbo Starks. That's Jabbo.
Okay. All right. Yeah. All right.
Because he played with two original drummers. That's
so who
Bobby
is this?
Right there, and that's myself in the background. That's Bobby Bird.
Mm-hmm. Okay, gotcha.
And that's me in the background. Mm-hmm.
I see you.
And
I
then if you look on the side right there, the woman, if you see her on the corner, that's Vicky Anderson.
Right. Right.
So that's gotcha. His wife. So if you remember right. in the movie Get On Up, she was the one that would make him not smoke the cigarettes and yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Marc, let's move up so, into yeah, now.
That was,
so
that was really
So let's okay. move up to now. So man, you're working on something, or you got something. It's out. It's on your website, and I'm looking at it. So mm-hmm. wonderful. So tell me about that So Wonderful project.
Well, believe it or not, at the time I had a couple people came to me, and I had done like an R&B album, like late 90s, early 2000s. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. years have passed and I've done a lot of things with other artists, but I hadn't done anything myself. So mm-hmm. a couple of guys came in and asked me, said, hey man, why don't you do an album where you're featured on the bass? You've never done anything like that. I said, mm-hmm. okay, yeah. And during the COVID situation, it was kind of a thing of like, hey, just started getting back into it, putting songs together. And I was like, wow, this thing may work. So it's like, I still use the R&B, what I call again, the Fifth Avenue funk roots as far as the music.
Yeah.
And, you know, one thing led to another and just started putting tracks. I was able to get some other folks to come in and help out musically and solo-wise. And when I look back at it, I was like, man, this is so wonderful to yeah. be actually, you know, to put something like this together. And yeah. that's why I came up with the name of the album.
Okay, So Wonderful. So now you've got you're pushing The Answer. That's on that album, right?
Yeah, there's two songs that are being pushed that actually have okay. music videos that goes with them. Mm-hmm. The Answer is one of them, and the other mm-hmm. one is H-Town Cruise.
All right.
So I was going to say, like, the H-Town Cruise is definitely homage to the city here. It's just showing love for the city. The Answer was, I wanted to do something that was kind of different as far as being a smooth jazz artist. I mean, mm-hmm. anybody can see somebody just stand up there and play, and that's cool. Don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I wanted the song to mean something. And if you mm-hmm. like really look at the video, you kind of understand where I'm coming from. Mm-hmm. Different types of situations. Where you see homeless people, people are dealing with the gun issue, you know, homeless people where, you know, they may have just been down on their luck, but, and at the same time, it's like, you know, you're just trying to bring something positive mm-hmm. to something that's negative. Even like in the video where you have a youngster that's trying to learn music. So it's like, hey, you know, give them the knowledge that you have to, you know, see them blossom. Mm-hmm. And just trying to do something that's positive. And so the answer could be in many ways and many things. It's not one answer is the end all to be all.
Gotcha. So I here's how people can follow you and get your music. So make sure you go and check out MarcAndreMusic.com. And you can go in and you get the whole album, or you can buy whatever you want off of there. Go and check him out. Real cool brother. I listen to his music and he's tight. Old school funk. That's what it is. You can tell he's a funk baby from back in the day. I hear it. So I love it, man. I love it. I really do. Man, look. It was so good for you to be on the show, brother. And when we get out, we're going to let people take a listen to and check out your song, The Answer. So, but man, awesome. Look, you're welcome to come back to the show anytime, man. Anytime. You're more than welcome, brother. It's a joy talking to you. Man, and I like those stories. Maybe when you come back, you'll have a part two of the Home Alone story.
No, I have one even better than Home Alone.
All right. Well, we'll catch that.
Yeah, this one here, you'll be cracking up.
All right. So, everyone, Marc.
You let me know.
I will. Everyone, this is Marc Andre. And, man, thank you so much for coming on the show. And if you like the show, make sure you click the like button. And also, what you do is share, and also you want to make sure you click the bell for the notifications. So, man, thank you so much for being on the show, and we'll catch you next time, man. Okay.
All right, much love, brother.